Hi, and welcome to chapter 2 of our Aerospike series. In the last chapter, we talked about the general working principles of the Aerospike and how it behaves differently compared to a bell engine. In this part, we want to go a little bit deeper and explain the more specific topics like altitude adaptation, expansion ratio, and its effect on the engine performance. We also want to talk how the peculiar design of an aerospike can improve the re-entry capabilities of a vehicle. At the end, we will also point out a couple of challenges that are present in the engineering of an aerospike engine. One of the main behaviors of the aerospike engine is the so-called altitude adaptation. But what does that mean and what's the benefit? Like Federico already explained in the last video, the aerospike engine, contrary to a bell engine, has a plug instead of an enclosed nozzle. Here, the supersonic flow is always exposed to ambient pressure and gets squeezed onto the plug. The exit pressure of the flow is always equal to the atmospheric pressure, making it optimally expanded at all altitudes up to the design point. Whereas the bell engine has just one optimally expanded point, it's optimally designed for one altitude. Optimal expansion then translates directly to an engine which uses the propellant most efficiently to generate thrust. This efficiency is measured with a term called specific impulse. The parameter that dictates the design point and therefore the specific impulse of an engine is called expansion ratio, and it geometrically describes how big the exhaust area is with respect to the nozzle throat area. Comparing the specific impulses of a bell and an aerospike engine over different altitudes at the same expansion ratio, it is obvious that the aerospike is already more efficient in the lower part of the atmosphere than the bell because it is optimally expanded in this region. As we increase the expansion ratio further, the bell's sea level specific impulse drops and the efficiency penalty becomes unacceptable. And perhaps even more importantly, at some point in an overexpanded bell nozzle, the flow separation at sea level would cause shockwaves that destroy the nozzle. But an aerospike is always optimally expanded below the design point. So as can be seen, at lower altitudes, we don't see a drop-off in specific impulse. In higher atmosphere, above the design point, the aerospike would perform the same as the bell. But that's not the end of the story, because the aerospike really shines is that you can increase the expansion ratio even further, way above what would be possible for the bell engine. This raises the vacuum-specific impulse and allows the aerospike to operate at superior propulsive performance at sea level as well as in higher atmosphere, where the effect on the delta V has the strongest impact. Unlike a bell nozzle, the only limitation on the expansion ratio is the diameter of the vehicle it's powering. Your aerospike can be as big as your rocket is wide, and that's an important advantage.
The benefits of aerospike technology do not stop at increased propulsion efficiency. In fact, an aerospike can be also effective when it is not firing. If we consider a reusable first stage, the main obstacle to bring down the rocket safely is the re-entry. During this phase, the stage decelerates from over Mach 8 to zero velocity, and the interaction of this high speed with the atmosphere creates high loads, high dynamic pressure, and a heat flux of around 1 megawatt per square meter, roughly one order of magnitude higher than the heat flux that the Sun radiates at the Earth distance. But if an aerospike first re-entry is employed, the shape of the plug can be used as a heat shield, which conveniently is already equipped with its own active cooling system, capable of dealing with much higher heat fluxes at the cost of a tiny portion of propellant. We performed such an analysis as part of the H2020 RRTB project. You can find some more info down in the description. Furthermore, the truncation level, which is how much an ideal full-length spike is cut, can be tuned to increase the bluntness of the engine and push further away the bow shock, thus reducing heat loads, all of this at the cost of a few percentage points of efficiency. Ultimately, these features remove the need for thermal protection system, which would be required for a bell. There are a number of engineering challenges around the aerospike design. The advantages it offers give it a competitive edge over the bell nozzle. The question now is, if the aerospike is so superior, why no one is using it? While it's true that the aerospike has some important advantages with regards to propulsion performance and the re-entry, it also has some important obstacles that make its development and manufacturing extremely challenging. One critical aspect of designing a rocket engine is to make sure that the engine doesn't melt during the firing. The internal temperature can reach more than 3500 Kelvin temperature. That can melt if not vaporize most metals. Therefore, a cooling mechanism is required. The most critical zone of a rocket engine in this sense, the throat, has far more surface area in an aerospike with respect to a bell, thus making the cooling more demanding. The aforementioned cooling and the peculiar geometry of the aerospike make the design and manufacturing of the engine a major challenge. This complexity translates into a heavier engine that leads to a lower structural efficiency of the entire stage. However, the use of additive manufacturing technologies can compensate for this. Despite a few tests done in the past, the aerospike remains a technology without flight heritage. Its altitude adaptation capability and the plume interaction with external flow has yet to be proven with actual flight data. But, well, someone needs to be the first here. Since the difference between specific inputs in vacuum and at sea level is higher, this difference is reflected also in thrust, causing a slightly higher acceleration at the main engine cutoff. To conclude, we've seen how the aerospike works, the main differences with respect to a bell, and the challenges that have prevented aerospikes from being more widely used. The altitude adaptation and the higher expansion ratio explain the higher propulsion efficiency, though the high complexity due to cooling and the low thrust-to-weight ratio lower the structural efficiency. Despite this, the net potential gain remains more than positive, allowing to deliver a higher payload to orbit. Although the lack of flight data represents the biggest source of uncertainties, we will fill this gap soon. In the next chapter, you will learn how the aerospike can ease the reusability of rocket stage and the sustainability that would derive. Thanks for watching.